Wranglers. I want to do a wrap-up of the Scarlet Letter. I want to focus on 3 points. I want you to comment on that. I'll be giving you some points for watching it and also commenting on this video. As you finished your reading and you looked at the last half of the book, the first thing I wanted you to pay attention to is the transformations in the characters. The characters change a lot in the story. Hester, in the beginning of the story, is young, passionate. She's defiant of the Puritans, and by the end of the story, she's very different. She puts up her hair in the bonnet. She wears a very drab dress. She doesn't draw any attention to her beauty. She does for that brief moment when she lets down her hair in the forest with Arthur Dimmesdale. You think they're going to run away together, but they don't. And then she puts it back up and she keeps it forever. So she goes through a transformation in the story, and she becomes a different kind of person. She, in some ways, she becomes way more compliant. They change the name. The A doesn't stand for adultery as the story progresses. Eventually it stands for Abel, because she does so much good for the poor and those types of things. But inside, in her mind, Hawthorne describes this character who was way more defiant than ever. If the Puritans could have read her mind, they probably would have burned her at the stake. She seizes the day when it comes to living on the outskirts of town. It gave her a freedom. She didn't have to, you know, they shunned her, but in shunning her, that she also was able to live life the way that she wanted to live, and also to raise her kid the way that she wanted to raise her kid, and she did. It was a unique way. Eventually, she kind of backs off and just kind of lets Pearl raise herself in some ways, because she couldn't make her compliant. So she goes through this transformation in the story, and then Dimmesdale goes through a tremendous transformation. In the beginning of the story, is the beloved, passionate, powerful, young minister with a future, and by the end of the story, he is weak and sickly, and he can't find any strength to take care of himself, and he wants Hester to confess for him. That's how weak he is. He's pathetic by the end of the story. And the thing that you guys got to ask yourselves is why? What causes that? I think Hawthorne is trying to show his readers the power of mental disturbance. This is a psychological story. You know, Arthur Dimmesdale never confesses in those 7 years, just holds that secret, holds that guilt, and it never goes away, and it just eats away at him. And then he also has somebody who's prodding it and making it worse and Chillingworth. We get an opportunity to look at a character who has guilt transform him in a very negative way, and by the 7 years end of the story, he's a very different person. And then there's Chillingworth. You know, Chillingworth, when he meets with Hester in the forest, you know, he asks her, do you remember what I was when we first knew each other, when we first got together? Wasn't I a good man? I may have been a little pedantic, but I was a good person, wasn't I? And she says, yeah, you were all those things and more, but what am I now? He says, I'm a fiend, and a fiend's like a devil. He completely transforms himself. And how does he transform himself? Through bitterness and dedicating his whole life to revenge. We get to watch the change in his character. And then Pearl, the strangest of the characters, you know, on the scaffolding, when the confession is made by Arthur Dimmesdale, Hawthorne describes a spell being broken. And in the first lesson, I ask you to think about that. What is the spell? And Hawthorne is suggesting, and I'm not asking that you agree with this, but it leads into the Puritan mindset. You know, the crimes that we commit and the sins that we commit, as they would say, they don't just affect us, they affect other people. In this circumstance, it's almost like the biblical idea of the sins of the fathers carrying on to the next generation. And Hawthorne plays into that Puritan idea with Pearl. And she's disordered, messed up, until things are made right. And things are only made right when the minister, Arthur Dimmesdale, confesses himself. Somebody can't do it for him. He wants Hester to do it for him. She can't. And in that really interesting scene, the minister's vigil, when he goes out in the middle of the night and Hester and Pearl meet him on the scaffold, the little girl says, will you do this tomorrow at noon? Will you confess in the open? That's what he has to do. He has to make things right. He has to pay for his crimes, and only then can Pearl be made right. In the end of the story, she is made right. It's really interesting how that's handled. A big thing that we got to ask ourselves is, what does the minister reveal when he's on the scaffold and he tears apart his robe? It calls it the ghastly miracle. The ghastly miracle. And you got to pay attention to the idea that it's called a miracle. The implication, it's an A. Well, the miracle part is, how does the A get there? I think the suggestion is that it miraculously eats its way out. Because it wouldn't be a miracle if he carved it into his chest. It'd be something you could explain. But that thing's called a miracle. It's a ghastly miracle. And I think it's a symbolic kind of thing that Hawthorne's playing with. You know, you can hide your sin, you can hide your crimes, but eventually they'll come back out. When he's on the scaffold, there's the stated moral of the story. And it's kind of unusual, a story actually states a moral. It's be true, be true, be true. The story is covered in lies. That's a big theme of our whole class all year. Deceptions and the taming of the shrew. People, you know, lying about who they really are, and there's something really different on the inside. Angelo in Measure for Measure. Macbeth in Lady Macbeth. Go back to Solzhenitsyn, the very first thing, Live Not by Lies. The lying in language in Animal Farm. 1984, you know, the deception in language. And, you know, when Solzhenitsyn says, live not by lies. You know, you can't change a whole system by yourself, but you can decide not to participate in lies. Well, Hawthorne is, I believe, very wise in the way that he understands the real threats that are coming in the modern age. And truth is one of those things. Truth is one of those things. We live in an age of all kinds of deceptions, and you all can figure that out. Who's telling the truth, who isn't, and what is the truth? What do words actually mean? You know, those are things. That's a Fahrenheit 451 kind of reference. So his theme, I think, is really relevant. Be true, be true, be true. And it kind of connects to a lot of things that we've talked about in class. Now, as we look at the conclusion, there's some interesting and puzzling things about the conclusion of the story. Number one, the irony of Pearl. The irony of Pearl is that, you know, that she was shunned for being a demon child early in the story, but she inherits a bunch of money in the end, probably from Roger Chillingworth, it's implied. It wasn't his kid, but he, you know, felt guilt and left it to the child. He had no one else to leave it to, and so he leaves it to that child. All of a sudden, the Puritans think of her as a way more eligible person. Same person she always was, but now she has money, and all of a sudden she's a better human. Hawthorne is pretty ruthless in pointing out the hypocrisy of the Puritans there. And in the other story, it seems like Pearl goes to the old world, goes to England, and she seems to have a good life. It implies she has children. But then the puzzling stuff, you know, Arthur Dimmesdale dies on the scaffold and is buried in an unmarked grave. But Hester is the puzzling part of the story. She decides not to stay in Europe with her grandchildren, and her own child. She decides to come back to New England, and she takes up her old abode, she takes up her old costume, and when she dies, she's buried. It's a puzzling end to the story, how people don't forgive and how the things we do stick with us and last, and why she went back. You know, was it love? Was it, you know, was it her familiar life? Could have been a lot of things, but she does go back, and that's how the story ends. So I hope you guys learned something from the story. I hope it was a good experience for you. It's one of the first American novels I can think of that becomes really, really psychological. That becomes the general direction of a lot of modern novels. They tend to be really like Saul Bellow. You know, those are, you know, not character or not plot-driven stories, they're character-driven stories, and you get inside the psyche. And so it's a very modern kind of approach to fiction. And I think Hawthorne is still relevant because he kind of paved the way for some of those things. So hope you learned some things. We'll talk to you later.